In a previous session, we talked about chemicals that are used in hydraulic fracturing, the types of chemicals, their amounts, their purposes. We have with us today Ms. Denise Tuck from Halliburton. Welcome, Denise.
Thank you, Dr. Puls.
Thank you for being here. Ms. Tuck has over 30 years of experience in the environmental engineering field. She has worked for Halliburton for over 23 years. She is the senior product champion for production enhancement. She also participates on the hydraulic fracturing team at Halliburton in regulatory compliance support of its business activities. She has served on several technical committees with the American Petroleum Institute and the Society of Petroleum Engineers. She has a chemical engineering degree from Auburn University and is a registered engineer in Texas. So one of the things we've discussed in the course regarding chemical formulation for hydraulic fracturing is the complexity of those formulations and the fact that the recipes can change from one formation to another depending on the nature of the formation, the physical, chemical properties of the formation. Can you shed some more light on that issue for us?
Yes, even unlocking the intricacies of each formation is what allows us to do our business and bring the production online as quickly as possible. And in fact, that's been the key to the shale plays, is how quickly you can unlock each one of the shale plays, and each one of the formulations vary sometimes formation to formation, and even within a formation, you can have variations amongst the wells that are in that formation.
So when you talk about unlocking a formation, what do you mean by that?
Trying to grab the best production out of that formation as quickly as possible. And it depends again on what you're going after, whether or not you're going after oil, gas, or both in some cases, and how you can bring that formation to the surface as quickly as possible.
So how you can optimize production, basically.
Yes.
Okay. One of the issues that we've discussed is the issue of using recycled water, taking flowback produced water, recycling that, and using it on the next hydraulic fracturing job. But that obviously must present some challenges when it comes to coming up with the right formulations for those types of jobs.
Yes, it does. Any types of different constituents can interfere with the function of certain chemicals in the fluid formation. So as we formulate the fluid, we want those chemicals to do certain things within the fluid. In fact, Halliburton has developed a new fluid system that can handle recycled water up to 300,000 parts per million of total dissolved solids and have other constituents present as well. This allows the operators to be able to use that water to build other fluid systems going forward and not having to dispose or truck or treat those waters.
That's one of the most amazing things that I've seen over the last few years, the fact that industry has gone from using fresh water in making up their fracturing fluids to now being able, as you say, 300,000 parts per million. That's incredible in terms of the concentration of total dissolved solids. So this now opens the door for using all kinds of marginal waters to do a hydraulic fracturing job, correct?
It does, with minimal treatment as well. And those waters can also be used for drilling purposes, for cementing as well. So you're able to reuse that water in multiple places across the play as you develop the play.
One of the other things I've noticed over the last several years too is there seems to be a trend to using less chemicals, and where things allow for it, what people call greener chemicals. Can you say something about that?
It's not just the use of the chemicals. Sometimes it's the deployment of the technology that allows you to use those new chemicals that go hand in hand with that. Halliburton has developed a new fluid system that is sourced entirely from the food industry. We believe provides a large margin of environmental safety in its use. there is also other things we've developed, such as we've removed the gel carriers to be able to produce a cross-linked fluid system. But in doing that, we had to develop the technology to deploy that material because it was a dry material. Those things go hand in hand, and it's not just the development of the chemicals, but it's the deployment of those in the the use of the technology to deploy those chemicals that go hand in hand with
it. Just to get those fluids down into the well. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, this chemical registry, Fracfocus, that the Groundwater Protection Council with the Interstate Oil and Gas Compact Commission, I think both of them collaborated on putting that together. How do service companies feel about that whole issue of chemical disclosure?
Halliburton has, from the start, supported Fracfocus and continues to support Fracfocus because we believe it is a way for the public to gain information on the fluid systems that are pumped in an individual well. We have supported that platform as well, even in other countries, such as Canada and Europe, because we believe it is important for the public to have access to that information.
Now, there's been some criticism of the Fracfocus website in terms of, first of all, it's voluntary, although I guess some states now actually require it.
Actually, it's over 15 states
15
now
states.
Require it.
Yeah, but there is this issue of proprietary information, in other words, confidential business information on some of the fluids that different service companies, and there's quite a few of them, and they're in competition with one another. So can you address this issue of proprietary information?
As in any industry, there are things that each company has that provides them a competitive advantage. That is what is deemed to be proprietary information. You know, the company invests millions and millions of dollars to develop this and to bring this formulation to the operators. So it allows them to get a leg up on their competition. If the proprietary information was made available, then the competition would be able to take that and reverse engineer it. In a very short order, it would negate our investment in all of our research and technology development that we've done, and it's millions every year. And that would stifle our company to bring more innovative products to the marketplace down the road to solve other problems, because if we're losing our competitive advantage, there's no reason for us to have that.
Right, and one of the things I've been impressed is how the agility of the industry, not just the operators, but also the service companies, to adapt to new areas, to new plays, to new types of formations, to new regulatory environments. I think that's been amazing. One of the things I know you and Halliburton have been involved with is the national EPA study on hydraulic fracturing and drinking water resources. And I know you've been involved at the very least in terms of providing them information, but also actively participating in some of their stakeholder workshops and events. Can you talk about how that participation has worked out?
Halliburton believes and wants to partner very much with EPA to bring sound science to their study. We've provided them in-depth information on techniques of hydraulic fracturing and on the chemicals that are being used in hydraulic fracturing. The workshops have been very informative. It's been a very collaborative exchange of information, and I think it will enhance the study going forward. It remains to be seen once the study has been issued how it comes out.
Yeah, that'll be about a year from now, I guess.
It will.
So I want to thank you for being here with us today.
Thank you, Dr. Puls.
And people should know that Denise is one of the foremost experts in this field in terms of these chemical formulations and constantly changing and upgrading these things. Thank you.
Thank you.